emblematic of what God has done in my life, and I recognize that really it could be representative of so many lives here. And many of you have different backgrounds and come from different places, and some of you will probably be in tune with some of the things I'm going to say here, but definitely this picture here could be emblematic of how God raised me out. So let me just launch into this. My young life, I wasn't raised holiness. I didn't come from a holiness home. What a blessing to be able to say that you were, but I wasn't. We were raised nominally Christian, my sister and I, in a single parent home. My mother was the one that raised us, and she did her best to raise us by the Bible and read the Bible to us. My grandmother was in the home, and we traveled, and in different places we moved, we had been through different churches, and there was at least one holiness church that I did go through when I was young. But somehow, the only view of God that I had was that he was incredibly powerful. I mean, you know, how do you not view God as incredibly powerful? But there was nothing inside of me that ever recognized that God was also loving and full of grace. And so somehow my view of God as I grew up became this God that really was watching over your life. And the moment that you messed up, you were probably going to get hit with the big stick and you might be snuffed out and you'd miss everything. Well, that was my view. You might wonder why I hadn't experienced grace to that point. I didn't get saved when I was young. I wanted to be good. I think all the Bible teaching and reading and all the Sunday school songs and all the different hands that were laid on me in some way when they were definitely put something inside of me that wanted to be good. But just to be honest, it was easier to be bad. Now, you don't have to say amen here, okay? Early on in our lives, we had no television in the home. We didn't listen to any worldly music. We probably held some pretty decent and rigid standards. My sister dressed like probably most of the ladies here, dressing in dresses, and we were conservative, if you want to call that. But slowly, as time went by, the values started to diminish in the home, and my mom probably let things in that she shouldn't have. And the television entered the home. We started to consume entertainment, and music started to move into my life, and the people that I began to be drawn to, the circle of people that I began to be drawn to, was increasingly wrong. Now, because I'd lived such a sheltered life, I kind of wasn't like all the other kids, and some of you probably experienced some of what that peer pressure feels like. You aren't like some of the others around you. You don't fit in, if you want to say it that way. And so because of that, what I found is when I didn't fit in, that there was this group that, you know, in our day, we probably called them the misfits, if you will. And that was kind of where I gravitated. The kids that made the jokes in class and the kids that cut up and made other people laugh. And that was a lot of fun. It's still a lot of fun. But, you know, that was the misfit group. That's where I fit into. And my mom's treatment of our home and the things that she began to allow in my life, I remember when some of the music that mom let me listen to, I was really actually quite surprised. Now, I was thrilled that she let me listen to it, don't get me wrong, but I was surprised she did. Some of the bands that I began to listen to were hard rock, and all I can tell you to this day, and I would stand for this to any young person, the influence that music can have on your life is so utterly powerful. The way that it can convey emotions to the heart. And so early on in my life, I was gripped by rock music, and rock then just began to move until where heavy metal music was what I loved and what thrilled me and what caused a surge of dark emotions inside of my heart. And I was just in love with that music, and in love with that music definitely led me to at least like that lifestyle. I watched that, and I really thought it was awesome. Well, as we grew up and as my band of misfit friends in whatever school or area we were in kind of changed around, I think some of the habits that I probably had were trending that direction. I'm going to be pretty open and honest with you about my life today, so I hope you're not shocked by some of the things that I'll say. Early in my life, in the years when some of these kids that are over in the other building are there, I began to play around with things like cigarettes. That probably doesn't scare anybody. It probably doesn't shock you, but early in my life, those were some of the things that happened there. And I remember when my mom, in middle school age, because of her asthma, had to move from Idaho, where we were, and she moved to Arizona for the drier climate. And there I was in middle school. And really, at that point, my place was cemented with all of the really bad kids. And they would go out in the neighborhoods and steal ornaments from cars. These aren't felonies that we're talking about here. You know, you're just not that bad of a kid. But these were the people that I was hanging out with. It's amazing how Satan will take your life and compare it to something really bad to show you how you're just not that bad. And so always there was somebody that I could look to and I go, man, I'm not that bad. I'm a pretty good kid. I had that desire. I wanted to be a good kid. But like I said, it was so much easier without God to be a bad kid. And so there was always somebody doing worse. There in Phoenix, as my friends got worse, Mom, at high school age, decided to move to the other side of Phoenix, the west side of Phoenix. And I can't tell you why it was at that point that it seemed like the hinges in my life began to fall away. But I remember distinctly that move. And when I was in a vehicle that was traveling over to where we were going to be moving into an apartment complex, and there was a group of young people that were sitting in a concrete Ramada, those big picnic tables with the concrete tops in a park. And I can't even tell you what possessed me that day, but I remember it so very clearly because as I was driving by that park that we were going to be living about two blocks from with my mom, I self-righteously pointed out the window and I pointed to this group of scrubby-looking kids that were out there in that park Ramada. Bunch of kids in concert t-shirts and long hair, and they just, you know, they looked like they were up to no good. They were bad kids. And I self-righteously pointed out the window. I remember to this day, and I told my mom, I said, Mom, I'm never gonna be like them. I felt pretty good. Car slid on by. We moved into the home. I met a few people in the neighborhood. You already know what kind of kids I'm meeting. I don't think we even started high school at that point. There I was supposed to start my freshman year. And my friend knew a couple of kids in the neighborhood, and those friends had a couple of friends in the neighborhood. And within a matter of weeks or maybe a period of less than a couple of months, you know where I found out that my friends like to hang out? Yeah. That little concrete Ramada down at the park that I had pointed at. I'm hanging out with kids now at this park, and as we're playing around with cigarettes, and I'm doing my best to look cool because this is a whole different class of bad kids that I'm with now, and I recognize it, like I'm kind of out of my league, but I'm keeping my head up in the crowd. I'm doing my best to impress them, and so, you know, we're smoking cigarettes, if you will. I know I'm being graphic here. Forgive me, parents. This is my life. I've got to tell you what it is. And all of a sudden, somebody takes something out, and the next thing you know, there's some marijuana being passed around inside of it. I'd never seen this before. My mother had never talked to me about it. Mom ought to know. And so this is floating around, and every single kid there is stepping up to this like it was natural. And it came my turn. And so, if you will, I want to say that time I did what you would call the Bill Clinton. Does anybody know what that is? Some of you do. You can giggle here. It's okay. You know, I stepped up, but I didn't inhale. It's a terrible way to describe it. But that was my first experience right there, scared to death, couldn't believe this was something that I knew was illegal. It was at that point, by the way. Being passed around so casually with my friends. Well, needless to say, it wasn't the first time that they'd done it, and it wasn't going to be the last time that I was confronted with it. And it began to appear regularly in the areas that I was. I remember distinctly when somebody came by my house to contact me to find one of my friends, and it was a local gang member. Didn't know this guy at all. But he said, hey, where's so-and-so? And I said, well, let's go over to his house and find out. Man, I was scared of the guy just being around him. And so we went to this guy's house, and he wasn't there. And so he said, hey, why don't you go with me? I came to get him high. Why don't you go with me? And he took me to his house, and he made sure that time that I really got wasted. I went home so scared. Young people, I can't tell you what it was like for the first time to be under the influence of something like that, but I was so scared. It was exactly the opposite of what you would think somebody that was on marijuana would be like. My eyes were wide open, and my pulse was racing, and I thought my mom was going to know, and I talked to her, and I was almost kind of going in and out of almost kind of a semi-consciousness, and somehow she didn't figure it out. And so what happened after that is I calmed down, and I realized, like, I fooled my mom. And I came through this, and actually it ended up being something kind of cool. And so the next time that it went around, I was able to do that, and I wasn't as scared. And the time after that, I wasn't as scared until this became normal. See, I went from cigarettes to marijuana just like that. 14. Probably 14 years old, 15 years old. My life began to devolve, and I found all the friends in my neighborhood that did those things, and those things began to saturate my life. And in high school, I did those things, and I'm the kid in the concert t-shirt now, and my hair's down here, and I'm listening to all of this crazy, horrible music, and I'm in a single-parent home, so my mom is working nights, and she is doing her best to put food on the table and keep a stable household going for my sister and I. But during that time, I'm just being horrible, and just the fact that she's working nights is pretty convenient for my lifestyle. I'm going out on the streets, and I'm staying out long nights with my friends. I remember when in my circle of friends, I began to notice that there were other people that were doing other drugs. And the next thing you know, this substance called meth, crystal meth, was being circulated. And again, I'm telling you, I wanted to be good. And so I'm looking at these people and going, these are some bad people. And I'm not doing that. So I'm actually pretty good. And eventually it became kind of commonplace in my circle of friends that these people existed. In fact, some of them became my close friends, and they're going to school with me, and they're all through the neighborhoods, and I began to find out where all the dealers were and whose parents did what, and you would just be amazed at the homes and what they did. As a matter of fact, my friend's parents, actually, that we stayed at their house all the time, they were heavy drug users, we found out, and one day they caught us in the backyard doing something, and instead of getting upset and correcting us, of course, because they do that thing, that too, they said, hey, why don't you just do it with us where it's safer? Can you imagine that? And so this home became a safe house for us to do all of these things. And my friends began to pressure me. Some of them, they said, hey, you really should try this. We've tried this and this is cool. I'm talking about meth. I'm talking about hard drugs. And I said, no, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. I'm not old enough. I'm not old enough yet. I'm only 15. When I'm 16, I'll be old enough. I'll be mature enough. I'll be enough of an adult to try something like that. Think of the logic in my mind. I didn't make it to my 16th birthday. July 4th. My birthday was in September. July 4th, I finally caved into the pressure. How do you think I remembered that? Well, not just because I was on a new drug, but because there were fireworks that night. Hello? July 4th, I tried meth and I was instantly addicted. And a whole new lifestyle opened up to me. Here is a 15-year-old kid who lies all the time to his mom, who knows all the dealers in the neighborhood, who has kids that are 5 years younger than him that are teaching him how to steal fifths of alcohol out of the Circle K down the road. Parents that deal heroin and marijuana and methamphetamines and all kinds of things. These are the friends that I had. I'm addicted to drugs. I'm lying all the time. My temper is horrible. This is my freshman, my sophomore year, and my heavy drug use is really starting to affect my home life. And I'll tell you of a few particular miraculous incidents that occurred, because really down inside, even though I was doing these things, there was a part of me that wanted to be good, but there was really no path for me to go on for that to happen. And so here I am just living the bad life, if you will. And I remember there were some kids at my school. There was a, you want to call them kids, there was a Hispanic gang. And then there was a group of our football players that kind of called themselves, by a name. And the two top of those had an argument together. And they decided that that little park down the street from my house is where they were going to meet and they were going to have it out. The whole school know about this. Amazing how amongst young people, everybody can know. You know what I'm talking about. Every young person can know something and no adult knows. How does this happen? Let's all get clued in, parents. Amen. And so the whole school knows this fight's going to happen. And they show up there and there's cars packed in the parking lot. And there's all these lowrider vehicles on one side of the street. And all these Hispanics are getting out. And they're lined up over here. And all the football players are over here. And the two meet on the basketball court. And they're going after it. They're really fighting. And the football player was a big guy. And he bested the other guy pretty good right there on the basketball court. And you would have thought that's where it would have ended. And we're all watching, and man, this is cool. I've never seen a fight like this go down. Wow, this is amazing. Nobody called the authorities the entire time. But it didn't end there. And one of the Hispanic gang members pulled a gun out of his pocket. And the others immediately began to run for their trucks and vehicles to get their guns. Who knew that they all brought weapons? And he fired a gun off. And the bullet ricocheted and shot the man next to him, his friend. and a person hits the concrete, and we are running. The first shot fired, we're running, and these Hispanic gang members pulled out guns and just began to fire indiscriminately. And I remember running across this park, and I remember running through children's toys and hearing bullets zipping by and hitting the sand and being scared for my life and running for my life. And I remember running to my friend's house, and the three of us got there, and we're breathless, and we're scared, and then we're relaxing, and then we're talking about it, and then we're wowed, and then before the weekend is over, really all it was just a really cool story to tell at school next week, that in a moment of time, my life could have been extinguished, and I could have gone into eternity unready to meet God. And God spared my life. My friends are getting worse. They're thieves. They're liars. They go out on the weekends. They steal stereos from other people that have more money than them. They trade them for drugs. I find out there's like this little undercurrent of black market and whatever around me. And I'm kind of with them. I didn't do a lot of it, actually. In fact, most of them, because they knew I was a little different, they wanted me to be the lookout guy, and that was just fine. I was the guy that told them when the police came. Probably kept me from doing a lot of restitutions, young people. Say amen. But these people that I'm knowing, I'm just telling you what bad people they are. And I was that bad now. I was as bad as the people 3 times ago that I had been pointing at. But there was always somebody worse, somebody more addicted, somebody more destroyed, somebody further down the line, some crazy. I remember when there we were at my friend's house and the parents asked us to go do a pickup for them. And so we jumped in their vehicle, my friend and I, and we drove down the street. It was a short 3 blocks away, and we turned, made a right turn, parked on the corner there, got out, walked a half a block back. There was a local Hispanic gang member. His name was Shorty. And at any point in time you went by his house, there were little circular marks where people had put putty on the front of his. You know what happened there, right? What are those little circular holes all over your house for, Shorty? People had done drive-bys on him so many times they'd stopped painting. They just puttied it up. Went in, picked up, hung out, did what we do, came out, feeling the effects, walking back. Shorty's walking with us. He's in front of us, riding a little scooter, my friend and I, and we're headed up to our car. He's just walking us to the vehicle. And as he's motoring that little scooter in front of us, I remember the Monte Carlo that came down the street. I remember the hard left turn it made to cut that same corner where our car was. And I remember the hand that came out of the window with the gun in it. And they unloaded that pistol, shooting at the very young man that was walking in front of my friend and I. He knew exactly what was happening the moment it happened. The look of terror on his face as he flipped around and grabbed that scooter and ran past my friend and I, who were dazed and confused, really just standing in the way of bullets. And he runs past to save his life while we stand there like a couple of idiots. And after it's all done, we make our way to the vehicle. There's a bullet hole directly through the driver's side window. Had we made it to the vehicle, one of us would be in eternity right now. God protected my life another time in the wrong place and the wrong time. My home life is completely, are you with me here? My home life is completely destroyed at this time. I'm arguing with my mom. I don't even make sense anymore. I'm just arguing to argue. I'm making her life so miserable. She's doing her best to keep the doors open for me to put food on the table. I'm probably a junior somewhere, a senior there, and my life is still being somehow held together. And most of my friends have dropped out, but the one thing I couldn't do was drop out. My mom wouldn't let me do that, so I stayed in school, and I'm making it through somehow. And I'll tell you one more story here. As I got picked up, and there was a friend that had a place out in the desert where we could go hang out, and somebody I didn't even know and my friend, we went and hung out to party on a night in the middle of the desert, and we're in the middle of the desert, and we're all high on various substances, if you will, and just, I guess, having a good time, and I got separated from the two. They were walking around doing something. It was a large acreage in the middle of nowhere. And as I'm out under the night sky, I cannot even begin to tell you what possessed my heart to do this. But I looked up into the night sky, and to this day, one of my favorite things is shooting stars. I love them. I love to see them. I live in a big city, and sometimes we don't even know there are stars. But I love to see a shooting star. And so I'm out in the desert, and I lift my eyes up towards the heavens. And of all the audacious things I could say, I said, God, if you're real, would you show me a shooting star? What would possess me to say that? I don't know. The thought comes out of my mind as I look up in the heavens and a star streaks across the night sky. That's pretty amazing. And so I said, God, if you're real, would you show me another one? And a star streaks across the night sky. I said, God, if you're real, would you show me another one? And another star streaks across the night sky. I don't know how long I sat there that night watching shooting stars. But I want you to stop for just a moment and think of a God that would hurl a star across the sky to get your attention. That's the kind of God we serve. I leave unchanged, unfazed, almost like I didn't even remember what happened, like it made no impact. But I think there was a God that was making some chess moves in my life at that point. Go back to my life, it's just as bad. I graduate high school, I'm a 120-pound wreck. I know I don't resemble that now, I'm very well put together. Thank you. I'm like a buck 30 now, too. My home life is just as disastrous as ever. And my mom and my grandmother, they're just like the tyrants. Thank you, Jameson, you're exactly right. Parents are tyrants. They are. Sorry, Brother Plank. They're the tyrants that are ruining my life. And I have this explosive fit of anger, one like I've never had before. I mean, it was a doozy, and I think I punched a hole in my door and knocked it off the hinges. Pretty cool, huh? Yeah. Showed them who was who. What did I get for that? I got kicked out of the house. Gone. Mom finally threw me to the streets that were already devouring me. And I can only tell you, in that short amount of time that I was out on the streets, I had a drug deal that went bad, and I exchanged cash when I shouldn't have, and more details than you need to know. All I can say is my life, again, came really close to being lost for being stupid, and God watched out for me. I came to a point on the streets where I recognized I couldn't hold a conversation, I couldn't hold my thoughts together, I couldn't hold a job, I was a total wreck, I'm telling you, I was a total wreck. And so finally, I remember one night I was so desperate, I was so alone, I was so confused, I was so horribly wrecked that I called my mom and I said, Mom, I'm ready to move back home. And she said, Gareth, she said, you know you're going to have to get saved and you're going to have to change your life and you're going to have to stop doing the things you're doing. And I'm like, yeah, whatever you say, yeah, yeah, yeah. I didn't even know what being saved meant. And so she brings me back home. But see, my friends are old enough now. They've got cars, so they're coming to pick me up. And man, I don't know any better. I'm going the same places. And I get invited to this concert, this rock concert, and this band is headlining, and I go with this person I don't even know, and I go to this concert, and we do the same things. We're partying, and I get out on the middle of the floor in America West Arena. Some of you know what I'm talking about. There's this massive arena, and there's thousands of people I've never seen, and I'm separated from my friend, and the music is raging, and yeah, it's kind of cool, but I kind of want to be out of there. In fact, my breath had started coming short to me. I'm really short of breath. I can't tell you if I was hyperventilating or if it was something I did that night that began to suffocate me, and I'm suffocating on the floor of the America West Arena amidst thousands of people that I've never seen before. Makes this crowd look incredibly small. And no one offered me help. And as the band is raging and as the music is pulsing and there's images flashing on these giant screens, it was as if God just took the veil off of my eyes, and all of a sudden I recognized that I was just in this incredibly demonic, evil atmosphere, and the music is horrible, and the visuals are horrible, and it's demonic everywhere, and the people are demonic, and no one cared. It was completely black and godless. And my breath is coming so short that I finally sank to my knees. I couldn't even stand anymore. You know, in the middle of America West Arena, not one person reached their hand down to try to pick me up. And I sank to my knees. And I've heard stories of people getting trampled to death in concerts. So I'm scared if I fall to the ground, it's over. And I press to my feet. And I remember a little voice inside of me that said, why don't you pray? I thought, no, not in this atmosphere. If I even prayed to ask for help, what an evil atmosphere. That would be horrible. I couldn't do it here. And I stand on my feet, and I'm waiting for the concert to be over. It's not over. I stand on my feet. I wait, and I go to my knees a second time. My breath is coming short to me. And that little voice, why don't you pray? No, I push myself to my feet again. And the third time, as I lose all my strength, and I go to my knees, I prayed this little prayer. I said, God, let me breathe. It was the biggest prayer I could muster. It took all my courage to pray that prayer in that evil atmosphere. There was no flash of light and there was no immediate touch on me, but I was able to regain my feet. And I stood for what seemed like an eternity until the concert was over, somehow made my way back home. I can only describe the next series of days or weeks or whatever it was as just this vacant void. I had some friends come and pick me up to do the same thing we'd always done. We went, we got high, they took a drive. We're driving around in West Phoenix. And I'm sitting in the back seat as two are driving, and I remember how still it got, so quiet. I'm looking out the window of the car, and out of nowhere, things began to catch my eye. I remember distinctly seeing on somebody's rearview mirror a cross dangling from the rearview mirror, swinging back and forth. That really meant nothing to me, but it jumped out like it was as large as life. We went further, and I'm not talking to the two in front. They're engaged in conversation, and I distinctly remember seeing a bumper sticker. I'm not a big bumper sticker fan, to be honest. But the bumper sticker said, Jesus saves. Out of all the things, you would think this was a billboard the way it stood out to me. But you see, that didn't mean anything to me. It jumped out, it spoke to me, but I didn't even know what that meant. And we drove on, and wouldn't you know, but I got to see another bumper sticker. And young people, here's what it said. Catch this. It said, no God, no peace. That was spelled N-O, no God, no peace. And then below it was this line, and you probably have read this somewhere before. No God and no peace, spelled K-N-O-W. And in my drug-addled brain, in my confused state, I want you to know that that message was as clear as any gospel message that's ever been preached. Somehow God took a bumper sticker and pierced through my sin-sick soul and let me know that it was decision day, that I had a choice to make. That my choice was either going to be no God or no God. I'd never known him before. I didn't know who he was. I had no idea what was going on. And so the car turned, as I recall, and we came to what is Thunderbird Freeway. It makes a graceful curve down, kind of a little sweeping turn, and at the base where Cave Creek is an intersection, there's a stoplight, and about a mile up on the right-hand side is the place I'm going to get dropped off where my mom lives, where I'm staying. And so at the top of this hill, as I'm looking through the back seat of the car, if you will, let me take your imagination there, and I'm looking from the back seat of the car through the windshield down this hill, there's a stoplight at the bottom, and a voice from nowhere speaks to me and said, why don't you ask God to prove that he's real? And as soon as that voice spoke to me, I knew that if he did show himself, I was responsible for that decision. Can you even imagine how in my condition, these kind of thoughts could be conveyed to me? That God literally brought me to an altar in the back seat of a car? And yet I was so hungry and so desperate and so ruined that as I looked through that front window and saw the stoplight at the base of the hill, the moment my eyes fell on it, I recall it turning yellow. And I thought, there's my one opportunity. There was a good stream of cars. We were far up the hill, and I thought, you know, if God could hold that yellow light down there, that's a big enough challenge for God to show that he's real. And so I thought in my heart, I said, God, if you'll hold that yellow light down there and prove you're real to me. The moment that thought crossed my mind, young people, I felt God's hand reach down to the bottom of the hill and grab a hold of the stoplight with one hand. And I felt the other hand of God reach into the back seat of a car and touch a lost, dead, sinful young man in a place that nothing had ever, ever touched him before. Stunned into silence, we drove the next mile. The car sails through the stoplight along with all of the cars in front of it. I already knew it was going to happen. I had no doubt in my mind as soon as God touched it. This is happening. The light holds. The cars go through. Ours up the hill drives all the way down. Longest yellow light in history, folks. Write the Guinness book. It happened. And we sail through the next mile up, turn right. Second house on the left, into the driveway. I get out of the car. I don't remember saying goodbye to my friends, but I get out of the car. Forgive me if I'm going over. I'm trying not to. And I go in, and the door opens. There's nobody home. They locked me out. I don't even have keys to the house. Have no idea to this day how I got in. I sink to my knees at an old white wicker couch, and I'm telling you, it's just like I knew what I was doing. The moment my knees hit the carpet, the presence of God came over my life. And all of my sins, all of the hardness of my heart, all of the horrible hurt and anger and drugs and confusion just went out the window like that. And the hardness of my heart pulled through like an old stiff knot pulling through on a rope. And I wept and I cried and I wept and I cried, and I was brand new and born again. And inside of me, I didn't know my theology, I didn't know God, I didn't know the Bible, but I thought to myself as the sins came off of me, I thought, that is what has been pushing me down all of this time, was my sins, and they're gone. Outstanding. God did a wonderful work and saved my soul. And I don't even know what happened. Mom came home, and years later she says, you know, when I came home that day, she said, I saw your face had changed, and you told me, you said, Mom, I prayed and I'm going to be good now. That's what I told Mom. I prayed and I'm going to be good now. And my sister was like, yeah, right. Because she's my sister. She's entitled to say that. She knew me. But it worked. God worked. My first confession of salvation was when my friends came and picked me up. Yeah, they did. I didn't know any better. I didn't even know what happened to me. But you see, when the drugs went around, I actually didn't want it anymore. I'd said I didn't want it before, but I was always lying. And now when they went around, they were like, did you want this? And I was like, no. And I was just as surprised as they were. And I remember this girl looking at me from across the room, and she said, did you get saved? And I was like, yeah. And I'm thinking, now how did she know what to call it? Wow, I'm saved. You know what happened? My friends stopped coming. Weirdest thing. We didn't have any more in common. And you know what else happened? I started mowing the lawn. Whoa. Now Mom knows I'm saved. I'm mowing the lawn. Yeah. You see, there's other evidences of salvation, aren't there? Oh, yeah. Things like that. Found out my grandmother had this connection to this little holiness church, and they were holding a revival all the way out in Mesa. It was an hour away, and she said, you want to go to church? And I was like, yeah. Oh, yeah, that was different too. And I went to church, and it was just a bunch of people having a regular service, and God was there. And I was like laughing and crying and having a great time. What? In church? Yeah. And I was like, you know, I think these people have what I have. They must really be Christians. And you know what? They were just nice enough to accept me as one too, because they were like, who is this kid? What in the world? What truck did he fall off of? Come to find out, the minister that's holding the revival there, the first revival he'd ever held in his life, but he doesn't hail from that church. The church is about 15 minutes from where my mom moved to. God orchestrated the exact timing, the exact purpose in my life to save me at the exact time when he could bring me through and step my foot through the door of a holiness church, the first church I got to worship in, and that became my mother church. Thank the Lord for it. Can I tell you that God still rescues? Amen. Can I tell you that God does an extraordinary job of rescuing? But can I stop for just 1 second more and tell you that he doesn't stop there? Isn't that wonderful? You see, it's wonderful to get rescued. It's like, wow, what do I do now? And especially when you're a wreck like I was, what do I do now? And most of you would be like, I have no idea. Who's in charge of this guy? You pray for him. He really needs it. And I did. And yet slowly God began that rebuilding process in my life. Isn't that awesome? When God begins to say, I started this. I'm going to commit to it and I'm going to finish it. You see, I knew right where I was going to pick up with his life. And all those pieces that were scattered on the streets, I'm going to pick those back up and I'm going to repurpose them somehow and repackage them somehow. And I'm going to use them. And so some of you young people that think that you're broken and some of you young people that think that you're scarred, don't you worry. God knows how to use that weird little version of you. You know who I'm talking about. You can say amen. Sanctified me. Called me to preach. What? Got married to a beautiful young lady. Yes, she's taken. All of you guys, forget about it. It's over. It's over a long time ago. Called to a church in California where I can go minister to people that probably look like what I looked like. And can I tell you right now that there are people sitting in my pews with stories very similar to mine. Rescued. 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 People that I can look in the eye and say, man, I know exactly what you're talking about. And there's a God that can do everything that you need him to in your life. Praise the Lord. Thank God for a glorious rescue. But young people, I want you to know, thank God for a God that restores. Praise the Lord. Appreciate your time. Thank you.